And yes, Lord, in faith we continue to be here to open our hearts to you and to thank you, Lord, for you are our God and we are your beloved and we belong to you. Here I stand. Brothers and sisters, in your heart, just say a little prayer of surrender to the Lord, thanking Him for calling us His beloved. And surrender all that disturbs us to Him. Surrender our open hearts to Him. And say your own prayer in your little heart. And we sing, I am yours.
I am yours, surrendered wholly to you. You set me and your family, calling me your own.
Let's worship Him.
Praise I bring.
I belong to you. Just close your eyes and sing. I belong to you. I belong to you, Jesus. I belong to you. I belong to you. Yes, Lord, I want to continue to worship you, to behold you, for you are my God. Lord, we come today and we just want to exalt you. Jesus, Son of Righteousness, you suffered for my sins. With stripes you brought me healing. In death you brought me life. And this life I now receive. As I sing this, Lord, and I proclaim and worship you as my God. Majesty of God, the risen Prince of Peace, Son of Righteousness, you suffered for my sins, with stripes you brought me. Death, you brought me life. This life I now receive. I will partake. I will partake of the righteousness of God. Redemption through. Of my sin, the riches of your grace and wisdom understanding, the mystery of your will in Christ we see. Thank you. Let's just reflect on Psalm 23.
The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me. Presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long.
The Lord is my shepherd, and I want to follow wherever he leads me, wherever he goes. Over the mountains, the waters and byways, valleys and highways, he's waiting for me.
Let this be our prayer to the Lord and while on the journey.
And while on the journey to where we are going, he promised to be there to help us along.
Thank you, Lord.
Over the mountains we'll walk on together to know given to me. I want to go to meet him there, to lay myself down in his love.
The Lord is my shepherd, and I want to follow wherever he. Yes, Lord, we want to follow you. And we thank you, Lord, for two good shepherds you have sent our way, Father Andrew and Father John. We thank you for them being here tonight to share your word with us, to share your plans with us. And we ask you to continue to bless them and guide them always. Amen.
So, very good evening to one and all. Once again, we come to our special arrangement with all the spirituality of the Archdiocese. So, this evening, we're with us Father John Chua. So, it's a Carmelite spirituality. Among all the saints, the Carmelites are the top notch for spirituality. We have two great giants, St. John of the Cross, St. Teresa of Avila, St. Teresa, a child of Jesus, so many saints under the Carmelite. So we have with us Father John Chua. introduction is an avid interest in statue and painting. And I come to know also a lot of churches, you have the statue painting, and some of the paintings or statue have been broken. The person to be sent, Father John Chua, he's the man. So, but after tonight talk, don't send all your old statue to him. He cannot help you. Only for big statue, all the small one, don't send to him. So he's a very good painter, has an eye for detail also. So Father John was a child. His baptism godfather used to import porcelain statue. This is where the story goes. The Church of Holy Family. And overwatched his godfather, who is devoted to Our Lady, paint the statue. That is where he got the vocation. So Father John painted statue, belonged to his family, relative, religious sister. Many people come to him, even churches. So he learned through trials and error, and he admitted he possibly ruined some of them, but now no more ruin. Now he's an expert. So Father John was previously also the superior of the house, and also he's a provincial of the house. He also passed novice master. So he also taught spirituality, if I'm not mistaken, the licensure in Carmelite spirituality from Rome and Apostolate, you name it, he's here. So tonight, without further ado, all the things about Carmelite, Father John is the man. Okay, so some of the saints, the great saints, St. Teresa, St. John of the Cross, St. Therese, Benedicta of the Cross, this thing we just celebrated on 9th August, St. Teresa of the Child Jesus, and many, many, many other saints. So without further ado, let's welcome, thumbs up to Father John.
Thank you. Thank you. And what I'm going to share tonight is probably just a reproduction of what has been taught to me by holy parents. I mean, through readings, through what I know, through what I learned from our faculties. So what I'm going to do is just a reproduction of what I've learned. And for an introduction, we will go straight into meditation. We call it discursive meditation, which is actually a reflection using images in the gospel scene, where as much as possible for those who can imagine, well and good, you just imagine that you are there with the Lord, with Our Lady. And for those who can't image in their mind, never mind, because these are just images from your own memories, from what you see. For example, maybe you have seen the Passion of the Christ. Use that image to imagine that you are there with Jesus. So I'm going to read a passage, a gospel passage, and then we'll start about 10 minutes of meditation. It's a guided meditation where I will just say something, describe this, the place, the scenery, the place where we're going to be with Jesus and our Blessed Mother Mary. Now, so I'm going to read this gospel reading from the Gospel according to John, chapter 19. Verses 25 to 27. Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Cleopas, and Mary of Magdala. Seeing his mother and the disciple he loved standing near her, Jesus said to his mother, "Woman, this is your son." Then to his disciple, he said, "This is your mother." And from that moment, the disciples made a place for her in his home. Now I invite all of you just to close your eyes and relax and let all your cares and worry go, the cares of today. Leave everything behind as you breathe along. And you may just, according to your own rhythm, try to relax and bring yourself back to time and space, to the time of the Passion. Imagine that you are there now. Imagine the place where the people are mocking at Jesus, especially the Jewish leaders and the Roman soldiers poking fun at Jesus. And even when he is on the cross, the people mocked at him. And there on the cross, Jesus is panting, is struggling with pain on his palm and his feet and all over the crown of thorns on his head, the blood oozing out. And each time he tried to breathe, he has to move his body. He had to shift his leg up in order to push himself up to breathe. And the moment he pushes himself, there's this terrible tear on his feet. And then as he hangs down, there's tear on his arms, his palms. And so this is a situation that Jesus is going through. And so we can imagine how much our Mother Mary, the Blessed Virgin Mary, at the foot of the cross. Now you may imagine that you are there, sitting, or maybe just kneeling or standing by the side of our Blessed Virgin Mary, who looks helpless, and she can't do anything but to ponder all this in her heart with much sorrow, with deep sorrow in her heart. And you're there, just simply there with Jesus, Mary, and then the holy women around and John the Evangelist. And the rest of the disciples have gone away, except for these people who are standing by Jesus in his agony. And Mary, our Blessed Mother, being the mother of Jesus, the mother of God, who feel the same pain in her heart, deep in her heart. And all you can do is just sit beside Jesus under the foot of the cross and with our Blessed Mother and the rest of the holy women, helpless. And this is the fact of life. Many times we do encounter problems in our own life and we feel helpless and even desperate, fearful. But then we cling on to Jesus and look at the feet of Jesus. And for those who are not able to picture Jesus, simply picture yourself just simply by the foot of the cross, waiting for Jesus. And as you look on the ground, you see droplets of blood. And that's the love of Jesus for us, who suffer for us. At this moment, in this silence, in solidarity with our Blessed Mother and the disciple whom Jesus loved, we too go into silence, wait on the Lord Jesus, and knowing that if we think that we are suffering, there are thousands, millions of people all over the world who are suffering, especially during this COVID time, this pandemic. And all we have to do, all we can do, is to just wait on the Lord, like our Blessed Virgin Mary, who is helpless, feeling very helpless. No amount of comfort can ease the pain of our Blessed Mother with all the mocking, the injustice done to her son. And so we know that still we encounter injustice also in our world, in our society. And there are many people who suffer injustice, or people who are scammed, people who are tricked, people who are murdered, whatever, people going through all kinds of troubles, poverty, hunger. We know that Jesus is bearing all this for the world and for our sins. Let us now, for another 5 minutes in silence, be in solidarity with our Blessed Mother, with the holy women, the disciple, John the Evangelist, and it's Jesus himself who is struggling on the cross for our sake. And Jesus did not think of himself, nor the Blessed Mother did not think of herself. They did not think of their own suffering, but they think of our suffering. They are concerned, they care for us. And so we in turn too, we look out of ourselves and see that we are not just the only person suffering, but people all over the world, all walks of life. As we thank Jesus for this brief moment with him and with our Blessed Mother and the disciple and all the holy women, we thank the Lord. And we praise the Lord for his love and mercy towards each and every one of us. And Jesus promised to be with us to the end of time. And we thank him for being with us all this while in our life. And many times we do not feel his presence or see his presence, or we think that he's not around, but he is always there with us, deep in our hearts. As we say, glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. You can hear me properly, well enough? All right. Okay, so maybe we, for a start, I would just like to give a very brief introduction of our Carmelite charism is about friendship with God. So Carmelite charism is about friendship with the Lord. And of course, the majority part of our community life is praying together, like the Carmelite nuns. So myself, the Carmelite friars, we are brother and sister order with the Carmelite nuns. And you can see in the second slide, the picture of John of the Cross, Teresa of Avila, and Therese. Just to need to know that Teresa of Avila is a 16th century saint, just like John of the Cross, who is her contemporary, Teresa of Avila from Spain. But Therese of Lisieux, many people might have mistaken Therese for Teresa because of the spelling. So normally, if we are referring to the little flower, Therese of Lisieux, the spelling should be T-H-R-E-S-E, Therese. So it's not Teresa, it's Therese. Whereas Saint Teresa of Avila with Spanish would be the proper spelling for her is T-E-R-E-S-A. So the three of them, they are doctors. And Therese, the little flower, of course, she's the latest doctor of the church within our order. These are the three doctors, Teresa of Avila, John of the Cross, and Therese. Now, Teresa will be the one who we'll be talking about tonight on her writings on the interior castle. But from time to time, I would also mention John of the Cross, who actually is her contemporary, and they write in unison. Whatever Teresa have left out, John of the Cross would complement. Whatever John of the Cross didn't say, Teresa would complement. So they actually, it's a kind of a collaboration in their works, but somehow I believe it's also the work of the Holy Spirit that makes them collaborate this way in their writings. And then Therese, the little flower, the 19th century saint, she is definitely the daughter of Saint Teresa, in a sense, following the spirituality and practicing, putting into practice the spirituality of John of the Cross and Teresa through her own little way, the little way whereby to do everything for the love of God. And so the charism, our ministry, especially for the Carmelites, is that we don't go and look for ministry, but our ministry is an overflow of our prayer life. And so we pray first and then we do our ministry. So this is very important for whether the nuns or the Carmelite friars. So now I go straight into the works of Teresa. And this is just a small portion of it because we do not have the time to share everything, but it is good. It is important to know that there are such things as the interior castle, the work of Teresa of Avila, that you may see here. Now you can see, all of you can see, I believe, the interior castle of St. Teresa of Avila, which she mentioned about the grades of prayer. And St. Teresa actually writes like a diary, and there's no system of maybe certain topics she was in general, and then she will start to talk about it and she jump about. So what we are sharing tonight is we try to put it into perspective in order. You can see the first mention, the second mention, the third mention, the fourth mentions, the fifth, sixth, and seventh. So these mentions are actually whereby they are actually part of our soul. So Teresa of Avila used the symbol of the crystal castle. Our soul is like the crystal castle, whereby there are seven layers. There are seven layers that go right into the castle, and at the center of the castle is the king who is God, who resides there, Jesus, our Messiah, our Lord, reside deep in the recesses of our soul. And you can see that the first mention means that we have to enter through means of prayer. So to enter into this castle is through the doors of prayer, Teresa of Avila says. Now, you can see the green boxes, the first, second, and the third mentioned. So these are about the degrees of prayer, first to the seventh. And it is starting from the methods of vocal prayer, meditation, and then active contemplation. So these are now just an introduction, a general introduction of the entire the schema. And you see those boxes in green, they are actually in the ascetical phase of our prayer, meaning that ascetical means that we have to do ascetical practices, certain self-denial, especially to do certain penance and prayer and almsgiving and all these things. And what is important is not just prayer itself. It's not just simply going through the different grades of prayer, but is also important at the same time, the theological virtues, our moral life, our faith, hope, and charity that is important. So the whole thing is that we should not be interested in where, what grade of prayer we are in. It's not for us to say. Because when we look at the blue part, the blue boxes, the fourth mansion, the fifth mansion, the sixth mansion, they are called the passive contemplation, then the beginning of union, or the simple union, and the sixth mansion is called conforming union, and the seventh mansion is called transforming union, whereby these are called mystical phase of prayer life, which very few, John O'Cross and Teresa tells us, very few, speaking for myself, very few of us, we are in that phase of mystical experience. So, but then again, it's good to know, it's not about where we are, what degree of prayer we are, or how holy we are, it's not that. It's about friendship with God, the whole thing. So Teresa says, prayer is nothing more than a friendly conversation with a friend whom we love so much. And that's it. And then she also mentioned that throughout our life, humility is the most important thing. And she used the image of the chessboard. When, you know, when, for those of you who know how to play the chess, the queen is actually very powerful. The queen can checkmate the king anytime if played properly. So she says that the queen of the chessboard is humility. So humility is that virtue that actually brings the king to us. So humility is not just about being humble. Humility is about knowing ourselves that we need God. Humility is also partly that we have to die to ourselves and to be detached. So this would be the most difficult part of our life. And it's a whole process, actually, the lifelong process. You and I, all of us, we have go through this process of dying to ourselves and dying in Christ. And this is what the cross teaches us. The cross, the suffering of Jesus, the dying to ourselves. And so at the end of the day, it is Jesus who died for us. And so coming back to, again, the degrees of prayer, Teresa tells us that this crystal castle is transparent. And right at the center of this castle, where the kings reside, there's this light emitting from the center. So we can say that this light represents the grace of God shining throughout the entire castle. So whether you are in the first mansion, the second mansion, the third mansion, the fourth, fifth, or sixth mansion, it's the same light that shines on each and every one of us, saints or sinners. The same light shines on us because our soul is like crystal castle whereby the glory of God shines on us. And our aim of entering into this prayer is to meet the King and to be in union with the Lord. So now I quote John O'Cross, who says that we are actually already in union with God the moment we are baptized. But then, not yet. We have still to practice virtues, to let go, to detach from ourselves, our selfishness, our ego, that we can open ourselves to the grace of God and go deeper into the castle. So again, it is not where I am or where you are in the degrees of prayer, because the light of God shines all throughout the first mansion, the second, the third, fourth, to the seventh. Now, speaking of, you may ask, what is mansions actually? Teresa actually used the quotation from the Bible in her own way. She says that, she quoted the Bible saying, Jesus, mentioning Jesus saying that, in my Father's house, there are many rooms. So she actually is trying to say that the way we enter into this castle is very different depending on how our background and who we are. But then again, the main door to enter is through prayer. Now, you can see now the first mansion, she says that as we enter the first mansion, there's always these reptiles we going in, and all kinds of reptiles or creatures that actually is that represents our attachment in life, attachment to anything. Can be attachment to the world, attachment to money, attachment to people, attachment to our selfishness, even in our own glory, we attach to our own prestige, beauty, whatever it is, we are attached to ourselves, and because we are selfish people. So in order to enter this first mansion, we first have to at least leave behind certain things and slowly get in to the interior castle. And so this, the green part shows that, or represents the part that we can actively work on it. That means we can do it with our God-given power, the grace that God has given us, that we can reach at least the third mansion through our prayers, through our own efforts. But then the blue part, that is the from starting from the fourth, to the seventh mention, it is a passive prayer, meaning that a passive night whereby God takes over. God takes over, and there also he purifies us passively. Now we can say about how this comes about, maybe roughly, when Teresa of Calcutta, remember Saint Teresa of Calcutta, she mentioned in her letters, and in, it was compiled in the book of Come, My Beloved, whereby she mentioned about the inner suffering that she's going through. It's not because she has lost her faith. It's not because she's bad. No, it's not that. God actually found her ready to go into the fourth, fifth, sixth, and the seventh mansion that God takes over passively. That means he will take over the person in the sense, it's not about possessing, no. God purifies the person and enters into this communion with the person, even in a deeper manner. And so the passive way, the passive night, we have no time to talk about this, but nights, now I refer to John of the Cross, when he say nights means that it's about purification. Night is because we can't see much, but we depend on faith. Faith that leads us towards God. But then at the same time, this night is also some form of purification, can be suffering in our life, challenges. And so to bear with it, so actively, you can see the green part again, actively in our life when we make sacrifices, these are called the active nights of purgation, whereby we actively, using our own human faculties, our own abilities, we can actually sacrifice a little bit here and there with our own efforts. But then, of course, with the grace of God at the same time. But as you progress, as a person progress into the fourth, fifth, sixth, and seventh, this purgation will be taken over by God. And according to John of the Cross, the feeling is not just horrible. No, it's not just terrible, but it's horrible. So Theologians say that this is like purgatory on earth. So we refer back to Saint Teresa of Calcutta when she mentioned, she mentioned in the letter to her spiritual director, she says that she felt like she's falling through a bottomless pit. And then when she told her nuns, her sisters, about to love as Jesus loved, but within her heart, she felt this emptiness, this desperation for God, looking for God. So this is the moment where God is taking over to purify the person. Deep in the person feels this desire for God, but at the same time, she or he couldn't find God. So this is a kind of a passive purgation that is almost like a purgatory on earth. So we can go actually in detail of this, on all this, but we don't have the time. So I will go back again to the first three mentioned, which is important. The basic foundation of our prayer life, the basic foundation whereby we start from ground zero, using this word, this phrase, ground zero. Every day in our prayer is about starting from ground zero. It's not about striving towards divine union or transforming union. So yes, all of us, we strive towards this union. But then is this union, striving towards union, is about striving towards the love of God and also the practice of the virtues of the theological virtues of faith, hope, and charity. So these are the more important things. When we come out of our prayer, when we come out of meditation, we have to put all these into practice. So going back to the first mention, she says is the method is called vocal prayer. And vocal prayer, as we know, we can, like, for example, we say the Hail Mary, the Our Father, when we say the Vespers, when we sing the hymns of praise and worship, all these are vocal prayer. But then with this vocal prayer, we can also go into meditation, like when we use the rosary, we say the Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. When we announce the first joyful mystery, the Annunciation, and then the second mystery, then we say Hail Mary, full of grace. So while vocally pronouncing the words Hail Mary, full of grace, we try to enter into this reflection, imaging as much as possible, if we can, the Annunciation, the time when Angel Gabriel spoke to Mary. And we can use as much as possible these images so that we can find ourselves there and at the same time purify, in a sense, purify our psyche, in a sense, or orientate our mind, especially our senses, the five senses, the sight, the seeing, the hearing, the touch, the smell, and the taste. And so we use these senses in our interior person, our interior self, and put these five senses in that gospel scene, whereby in a way is a kind of orientating all our five senses, using our five senses to good use through imagining you to step into the house of our Blessed Mother and imagine that you can see her in your mind, in your imagination, imagining that you can even smell the maybe the cooking of our Blessed Mother who left, who is cooking something for whatever. And you can feel the light that's coming in, or you can see the light that is shining into the room where you see our Blessed Mother talking to the angels, but we can't see the angel, Gabriel, but it's just your light. And so these are the imagination that we can use in our meditation. So the second mention, when we talk about meditation, especially when it comes to Christian meditation, it is about meditating, not like the Buddhist way, blanking our mind, but to meditate on the life of Jesus, on the life of Mary, through the gospel. When we read the gospel, or sometimes they call it Lectio Divina, when you read over and over again, or sometimes they call it the way of like the Ignatian way, whereby you imagine yourself in the gospel scene, you talk to the different characters in the gospel, maybe even have certain conversation with our Lord Jesus, or maybe you can imagine that Jesus is looking at you and in the Garden of Gethsemane, welcoming you to pray, all these things. This is meditation. So we call this meditation discursive prayer. Now, also for you, it's also important to know, St. Ignatius, the Jesuit, they have not really separate meditation and contemplation. So Ignatius would use the word contemplation. He doesn't use to meditate. So for us, for the Carmelites, in a way, meditation is using imagination, image of the gospel scene, and they call it discursive prayer. That means you ponder. You can ponder on the love of God. You can ponder on maybe the our life together with our Blessed Mother. In this sense, we ponder. And just like our mother, she ponder everything in the heart. So like our Blessed Mother, we ponder together with her, but through the gospel. So for Teresa and John of the Cross, it is very important to use the gospel, the Bible, to ponder, to meditate, and not just to blank your mind. This is not the time to blank your mind. And in this meditation, whereby when we say the rosary, sometimes we cannot pronounce the word properly or slowly, never mind. We just continue just saying the Hail Mary, but at the same time, we concentrate on the imaging of the life of Jesus in the, for example, the first the sorrowful mystery, for example, maybe Jesus in Garden of Gethsemane. We go inside there. So this is meditation, using discursives, using images as much as possible. And then there'll be a time during this meditation, there'll be a time of effective prayer. So in meditation, there are many different levels or so whereby at times you just simply feel affectionate, emotional, you would want to cry, never mind, cry out. Or sometimes you just feel dry and you can't meditate anymore. Then you have, maybe you notice that you are just able to be alone with like Jesus, and then the gospel scene disappear, the images disappear, simply in the presence. For example, just now when we say the prayer in the meditation, that we just simply sit by the side, under the foot of the cross, by the side of our Blessed Mother, simply that, without image, without anything, but knowing that we are just sitting beside them, waiting. So this is another step of meditation whereby the images are gone. And for those of you who can't imagine, well, this will be the way you do it. So St. Teresa, actually, you're not alone if you can't imagine. St. Teresa herself says that she's very bad at imagining. She's very bad at picturing. But all she did most of the time for her prayer, her methods of prayer, was to not exactly picture, just to be in the presence of Jesus tied to a pillar, in the presence of Jesus tied to a pillar being scourged. And all she could do is to feel herself so unworthy to wipe even the blood and the sweat from Jesus's brow. And so this is a meditation. Or sometimes she looked at the picture of the painting which her father bought and put in her monastery, the lady at the Jacob's Well, the Canaanite woman, and she reckons herself as the Canaanite woman conversing with Jesus. And then sometimes she can't meditate. She will use a book, a good book, and read. And once, or maybe the gospel itself, and when you read, and when certain words touches you, stop. And then you just ponder on the word. Maybe Jesus say, "Woman, this is your son. Son, this is your mother." And you just ponder, "Who is Mother Mary for me? Who is my mother? who is Jesus to me, my brother? And so you ponder. And sometimes we are still, now we are still at the second mention. Sometimes Teresa says she used another method whereby she says the Our Father slowly. She say, Our Father. And then she'll stop there, ponder. And then pondering on the wonder of God, the greatness of God, pondering, dear Lord, how great you are. And just pondering. Or even without words, just simply knowing that you are thinking of the greatness of God, then hallowed be thy name. Then you go on by saying, God, you're holy, and only you are holy. Make us holy through your Son, Jesus, or forgive our sins. Make us humble and holy. So we can do this through the Our Father. And see, this is what are the various methods in meditation of what Teresa of Avila did. And then if we can't meditate, then at all, when we find ourselves getting drier, it can be so dry, or maybe due to distraction. If it's not due to distraction, it can be distraction, but sometimes we just simply want to be quiet. And so you go into the active contemplation, whereby our prayers get more simplified. And so these are the times when we feel the affection also, the affection of maybe just the presence of God, and know that these affections are still within our human faculty, our human emotion, our psyche, our own. Maybe this affection could possibly, of course, through the intervention of the Holy Spirit, revive this memory of how much we have been loved by our parents. And this is transferred towards God himself, of how much God is loving me. So still, it is very human at this level, the third mention. But in any case, one has progressed into this kind of meditation whereby it is more and more simplified, whereby you just sit there quietly and be in this loving attention. John O'Cross, now I jump to John O'Cross. John O'Cross says, is this loving attention as if you are being loved by God? Just allow God to love you. So by this manner of allowing God to love you during this so-called the active contemplation, lovingly allowing Jesus to love you, or just lovingly staring at the cross, lovingly sitting by, waiting. That's it. As if you're waiting for somebody who never comes, for somebody whom, or maybe waiting for a friend, and you wait. And then you're supposed to have, for example, you have an appointment with your friend, and your friend didn't turn up. Maybe you give excuse, maybe never mind, maybe it's traffic jam. Again, 1 hour time, no, he or she didn't turn up. Then you say, never mind, I'll just wait. So in dryness sometimes, in our, maybe even, maybe it could be the cause of our challenges in life, or maybe problems that we are facing that makes distractors from that. Never mind. Use that distraction as well, this dryness and this pain, and just be there together with our Blessed Mother. And so this is another way of this active contemplation, actively waiting on the Lord with all your cares, with your worries. It always come in. You try to leave them behind, but you come back again. Just says that, Lord, I think you suffer more, millions of times more than me, but I'm putting this at the foot of your cross. Just simply, quietly, actively, in this loving attention, together with our Blessed Mother. Or sometimes you just lost, you're in loss of words, and you can't speak at all. Just be with our Mother. That actually, instead of trying to console our Blessed Mother, she consoles us actually. And maybe when we console her by sitting next to her, she's actually consoling us. So this is how we understand by active contemplation, by we it's a kind of active way exchanging our love for God, exchanging our love with Christ. And we know that the heart of Mary is in union with the heart of Jesus. And definitely, Mary is in union. She's in this, we can call the transforming union, right from the start of her birth, the Immaculate Conception, because she's one with God, the chosen one. And she is actually, we can say that in the seventh mention, she's already transformed in God. And her heart is conformed to God. Her will is conformed to God's will. Whatever she does is God's will. Is whatever God's will, she will do it. And so her heart is in conformity with that of Jesus. And so you can imagine the pain that she felt in the heart when the lance pierced the heart of Jesus. And so we can imagine how much our Blessed Mother suffered for us. And of course, because of her son as well, together with her son. And so this is an internal suffering. And so when we talk about this internal suffering, as a person progresses into the passive night, we see the blue part, the fourth mention, which is called the passive contemplation, it gets drier. You will not be able to reach this stage by your own faculties, by your own self, by your meditation, by your active contemplation, by your emotions, nothing. God takes over, actually. And so at this stage, this is the beginning we call passive contemplation. So you can see the blue part, passive contemplation, beginning of union, conforming union, transforming union. This will be, there's no method. We can see the green part, the green squares, whereby it shows the first three mentions. These are having methods. We have methods. We have methods using our own faculties, our methods, our memory of how Jesus might look in the painting, how we've been loved by our parents. We transfer it to the love of God, how we understand the smell of the olive tree. Maybe we go enter the garden of olive, the garden at Gethsemane. We use our senses to smell. But these are the methods. The green boxes are the methods, the three mentions. But as one progresses to the fourth, there's no method at all. We can't use any method because it's a mystical phase of one's prayer life. And then this God takes over. And then when union comes about, and then conforming union, the sixth mention, whereby ecstasy comes about. And so these ecstasies are mentioned by John Cross and Teresa herself, and they went through ecstasy. But again, they say ecstasy, like floating in the air or whatever, feeling the arrow piercing your heart, where Teresa actually, she had this transverberation whereby the angel appeared and pierced her heart, and she could feel this pain, this exquisite pain and sweetness she can't describe. On one hand, it's so pain, the pain of the suffering of Jesus. On the other hand, it's the sweetness and the love of Jesus. So this we can't understand. These methods, we can't reach this kind of feeling of, or so-called feeling of mystical phase of our prayer life. So we may or may not, maybe from time to time, a little bit, we are given a little nutshell of maybe a taste, a foretaste of what it is, but we are not completely given the foretaste of what it means to be in the conforming union and transforming union. And so during our meditation, we may have some inspiration from the Holy Spirit who teaches and instructs us intellectually. And of course, through the meditation of Bible, we learn through the meditation of the life of Jesus and Mary and Joseph, we learn. But then as we go further, we find that whatever we have learned, it actually, if a person, for example, if a person has gone into the fifth, sixth, and seventh, whatever he has learned, you have to let go again, because whatever we understand, whatever we know, even through inspiration, is even now, has to be left behind and God takes over. In this sense, even spiritual attachment, we may think that there's a beauty in certain things, the beauty in our prayer, beauty in certain statues, even spiritual things that we are attached to. Even all these things, they are good, but in themselves, they may be a hindrance. So at this point, when a person goes in the fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh mansion, they have to let go of everything, even things that they think is spiritual. So John Rocross says that if during meditation, if you see an angel, the vision of angel, ignore the angel. He says that the vision of the angel can come from our desire of seeing the angel or seeing God. And then the vision of the angel could come from the demonic sources. And then also by clinging on to this vision, we may think that we are really high up there because we have the vision of God, we have vision of the angels. So this will actually stun us. We won't continue further down into the fourth, fifth, sixth, and seventh mansion because we are clinging to something that is not actually God. It's only a taste of God, the shadow of God. And so whatever things we have, the whatever inspiration, vision, well and good is for us, but God is throwing sweets, consolation, sweetness, all this in our beginning stages of prayer, feel sweetness and this consoling prayer, and God is consoling us. These are, John Cross says, God is throwing sweets for us so that to attract us to further into this union with him. And then he would remove all the sweet, then put bitter herbs. So he used another image. When God calling us into a deeper union with him, it tastes bitter. Where he says, like in the past, in the ancient times, when baby, when mother wants to be wean the baby from the mother's breast, they will put bitter herbs. And so when the baby tastes the bitter herb, they will just wean away from the mother's breast. And so the baby will have to walk. The baby will have to on his own, in this sense. And so these are the nights, the person going through the nights of the senses and the spirit, the passive night whereby God takes over. So no more sweetness. And this, that's why we can't go by the way of methods, no more methods, but to allow God to take over. And we don't have much time to talk about all this, about detachment, about the purification of the nights. But what is important, we just go back from the ground to ground zero every day of our life. If we cannot meditate, we look at the book, we pray vocally and we read the Bible, or we meditate on a certain spiritual book, and then we go into meditation. If you can't meditate, just be in this loving attention. So these are the three steps we can take and able to take on our own. But at the same time, we have to just remember that it's not about meditation and contemplation. It's also about our life. So the meditation and contemplation will carry forward towards overflow into our life in faith, hope, and charity. So in the practice of faith, hope, and charity. So this, the practice of faith, hope, and charity is called the ascetical phase. You can see on the right-hand corner, ascetical phase, the yellow part. But then as for the mystical phase, it's not for us to want to go, but it's God to say when we are ready. When he gave Teresa of Calcutta, the more recent saying that we can use as an example, a very practical example of how she felt when she was called to start the missionary of charity, the sister of charity, to when the moment she answered the call of Jesus, she went into this dark night, the passive purgation. Whereas on our, for normal people, it is called the active purification, where active purgation, whereby it's ascetical. The ascetical phase where we practice self-denial, we make little sacrifices, maybe we don't eat the things that we like to eat, we try to avoid gossiping, we try to be kind to people. All these are called ascetical practices and active purification of the ninths, of the senses and the spirit. Now, for people like Mother Teresa of Calcutta, definitely she has been practicing all the time, actively the ascetical phase, but at the same time, she experienced the mystical phase. But then again, it's important to note that the mystical phase doesn't mean that a person like Teresa of Calcutta would be floating around like Teresa and some of the saints, or maybe stigmata Padre Pio, Saint Pio, where the stigmata, they will manifest all these mystical signs. Because the more you manifest, the more difficult it is to canonize a saint. So the more miracles you perform, the more miracles, the more the congregation of faith in Vatican would have to really to certify that these are authentic miracles, of, and so it takes longer to canonize a person. And notice that Teresa of Calcutta, she was canonized very fast. Why? Because of her practice of faith, hope, and charity in her life, in her generosity towards the poorest of the poor. And so these are the proof of her sanctity, her humility and sanctity. And so these are the things that Teresa of Calcutta has gone through. It's a terrible purification that only God will bring us there. But as for now, you and I, all of us, we start from ground zero. We are back to the first mansion, the second mansion, the third mansion. At the same time, try to be detached. We learn to be detached. So detachment is a big word. It's easy to pronounce, but it's a huge word. And so finally, we look at the last chart, the diagram, So it's not a linear form. When a person reached transforming union, you can see the right-hand side, transforming God. According to theologians, this person would not fall into sin anymore because they are transformed, just like our Blessed Virgin Mary. And however attractive the world is, because the love of God is so deep, she is one with God that the world will not attract her at all, whatever, how, no matter how wonderful or beautiful. Definitely we admire the creation of God, but at the same time, it is not this world that attracts us, it's God who attracts us, the love of God and the creation of God, which is his shadow. And then again, this graph shows just a straight, some plain sailing kind of journey. You see, when our ego is so big, you can see the man is standing there so tall. We want prestige. We want this. We are attached to this, with that. So God cannot fill us in. The blue line is the blue arrows whereby God can fill us in. But since we are so full of ourselves, God cannot fill us in. So that's why the journey towards union with God entails that we need to be transformed. We need to, first of all, respond to the grace of baptism through the theological virtues, faith, hope, and charity, and through our detachment, and dying to ourselves. And dying to ourselves is the dying to our ego. And all of us, we are full of ego, we are self-will. So that's why when our ego dies, our will conform to God's will. That's why we have the, if you remember when I mentioned the sixth mention, is conforming union. That's whereby, conforming union is whereby Teresa used this picture of the betrothal, like engagement. We call when you're engaged to your fiance, you know, you wear the ring and say, I will make this promise that I will, we are engaged to each other, conform to each other. So then waiting towards the wedding day whereby Teresa used the transforming union as spiritual marriage, whereby the person is one with God. So when our ego dies, when we die to ourselves, the more we die to ourselves, the more we are open to the Spirit of God. That means the more we enter and discover God within ourselves. But if we are full of ourselves, definitely we can't discover God within ourselves, inside, right in the deepest recesses of our soul. That's why Teresa says our soul is like the crystal castle. Right at the middle is God shining. His light is shining. And so God is there. And it's up to us now to let go of all our craving, our attachment, to try and enter this. So meditation requires that, if we're doing just simple meditation, it requires that we are not just saying words, but we have to sit down and give some time for God. And especially when you go into active contemplation, we have to sit. Maybe for a start, maybe we try 10 minutes, 15 minutes, half an hour maybe. So we meditate on the Bible. And sometimes when we meditate on the Bible, the time passes so fast. It can be just half an hour, 1 hour just pass like that. So we can try. But for many of you, you might be working and you not have not much time to just sit. Maybe for a start, maybe if you are at home or in the office, before you start, you just have 10 minutes of quiet time and just be in the loving presence of the Lord. Or maybe if you are in difficult troubles, in difficult times, especially in this COVID time, worries of sickness or financial difficulties, you just be at the foot of the cross of Jesus with our Blessed Mother who feel helpless. And so when you see that our mother is helpless, you know that she is being helpless for us, being helpless with together with us. And so this is this other way that we can tune our senses, our intellect, our will and memory towards this, the gospel. And from this, when we tune ourselves, our mind towards God, towards the life of Jesus and Mary and Joseph, the more we're able to act out in our life, in our daily life. And so it is important that also note that our ego doesn't mean that we are just plain sailing from our huge ego to a very tiny one and disappear. No, it's sometimes we go from the first to the second, to the third, to the fourth, and then we go back to the first again. So again, Teresa tells us also, meditation, we should not blank our mind. We cannot skip too fast towards blanking our mind. Don't blank your mind. We need the meditation of the Bible to increase our faith, to the input, like now we're doing input of our faith, the content of our faith, that who is Jesus? Jesus is God. Jesus is the Son of God, the third person of the Holy Trinity. Who is Mary? The Mother of God. And so when we reflect on this, we learn. These are the input. So when as much as we can meditate, we meditate on the Bible until a time where we just can't, we just simply want to be alone, then leave behind. Don't try to meditate. Don't try to image. Don't struggle. If for those of you who can't meditate anymore, don't struggle. Just or clench your hands and say, why I can't meditate anymore? I can't feel any sweetness. Never mind. In this dryness, sit at the foot of Jesus. Sit at the cross of Jesus. And then with our Blessed Mother. And so maybe we end this talk because it's about 9 o'clock now. And we can share more next time because there is so much to share regarding this transformation. And so I hope that the Lord will teach each and every one of us in our daily life, in our prayer, how to pray and how to be friends with Jesus and how to converse with Jesus. It's not just about feeling sweetness, but even in times of sorrow, even in times of pain, we can still know that Jesus is with us. And so we say, glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
So we like to thank Father John Chua for this wonderful talk. It's not easy. Yeah? We are talking about mystical prayer put into human language. Sometimes you talk about prayer. How do you put into words? I think as I try to put in a nutshell, over and over again, I hear Father John Chua repeating ground zero, over and over again. So tonight, you have a wonderful prayer experience. You feel very high. You feel that in the seventh story, tomorrow begin again at ground zero. Not on the seventh. You cannot remain the same time. So in a nutshell, Carmelite spirituality is a friendship with God, journey towards the union with God. That is important, a friendship with God. When you have a very good friend, you don't have to talk much. How are you? How's the weather? How's the food? Have you eaten? No, you're just being silenced, gazing. And the Carmelite spirituality is also very Mariam, very Mary focused. At the foot of the cross, he's mentioned that Mary pondered all these things in her heart. And it is very important. So you take home with you today or this evening, sit before the Lord, just being silenced, solitude. And the Carmelites has given the church this great spirituality of solitude, of silence, in which all of us have found lacking in this time. So, and also you look into the church also, the four great doctors, women doctor the church, two of them are from the Carmelites. You have St. Teresa Avila, St. Tris of the Child Jesus, or St. Tris of Lisieux, the Carmelite, and you have St. Catherine of Siena, the Dominican, and the last one is St. Hedegaard of Bijan, which is a Benedictine Albers. So four women, four great women, two of them from the Carmelite tradition. So very important. And some of you have been mentioning, you see the name, Father John Chua, OCD. What exactly is OCD? It's not obsessive compulsive disorder. Many people say it is what? Order of Carmelite Discalced. Discalced are those who are barefoot. They belong to the friar tradition, like the Franciscan. And if you go back to the Carmelite spirituality, it goes back to Mount Carmel. Okay, go back to the prophet Elijah. Go back to a long time. So they have the patron, that's Mount Carmel, where there's whole spirituality, the hermits of Mount Carmel. They built a chapel at the top of Mount Carmel and pray to Our Lady. And over the years, you develop the Carmelite spirituality of man and woman. So once again, we thank Father John. And before we go tonight, also very important, let's have a night prayer. Okay, have a night prayer. Join in the night prayer. And this is in Zoom. So join in. It's very beautiful. It's an enchanting. Some of us are not used to it. I think it's a beautiful chanting with the background scenery. Without further ado, let's go to the night prayer and then we do the announcement and we close for the night.
To my aid, Lord, make haste to help me. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. As shadows lengthen into night, Maker of all, we pray to you. Show to us still your tender care, and guard us with your princely power. Far from us strive all evil dreams and wicked thoughts that prowl at night. Dread underfoot our evil foes, and keep our bodies free from stain. Almighty Father, grant our prayer through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who with the Holy Paraclete and reigns with you in endless light. Amen. When I call, answer me, O God of justice. From anguish you release me, have mercy and hear me. O men, how long will your hearts be closed? Will you love what is futile and seek what is false? It is the Lord who grants favors to those whom he loves. The Lord hears me whenever I call him. Fear him, do not sin. Ponder on your bed and be still. Make justice your sacrifice and trust in the Lord. What can bring us happiness, they say? Lift up the light on your faces, O Lord. You have put into my heart a greater joy than they have from abundance of corn and new wine. I will lie down in peace and sleep comes at once. For you alone, Lord, make me dwell in safety. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High and abides in the shade of the Almighty says to the Lord, my refuge, my stronghold, my God, in whom I trust. It is he who will free you from the snare of the fowler who seeks to destroy you. He will conceal you with his pinions, and under his wings you will find refuge. You will not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the plague that prowls in the darkness, nor the scourge that lays waste at noon. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 fall at your right. You it will never approach. His faithfulness is buckler and shield. Your eyes have only to look to see how the wicked are repaid. You who have said, Lord, my refuge, and have made the Most High your dwelling, upon you no evil shall fall, no plague approach where you dwell. For you has he commanded his angels to keep you in all your ways. They shall bear you upon their hands, lest you strike your foot against the stone. On the lion and the viper you will tread, and trample the young lion and the dragon. Since he clings to me in love, I will free him, protect him, for he knows my name. When he calls, I shall answer, I am with you. I will save him in distress and give him glory. With length of life I will content him. I shall let him see my saving power. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. O come, bless the Lord, all you serve the Lord, who stand in the house of the Lord, in the courts of the house of our God. Lift up your hands to the holy place, and bless the Lord through the night. May the Lord bless you from Zion, he who made both heaven and earth. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Be sober, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Resist him, firm in your faith.
Now, Lord, let your servant go in peace. according to your promise. All my eyes have seen the salvation which you have prepared for all the world to see. The light of revelation for the Gentiles and the glory of your King, O Israel. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Let us pray. Lord, visit this house and family and drive from it all the snares of the enemy. May the holy angels dwell here and keep us in peace. And may your blessings be upon us always, through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord of all strength and mercy, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless and watch over us. Amen.
Salve Regina, Mater Misericordiae, Vita dulcedo, et spes nostro salve. A te clamamus, exsules filive, a te suspiramus, gementes et splendes, in hac laurimam vale. Ea ego, advocata nostra, illus tuus misericordes onculos, ad nos converte. Et Iesum, benedictum fructum ventris tui, nobis post hoc exilium ostende. O clemens, O
was a very beautiful night prayer as we end the night. Couple of things, the announcement. So we have have the perpetual adoration 24 hours. And despite our busy schedule, you can spend some moment, you can zoom in and just be in silence with the Lord, just being a friendship with Jesus. Especially during this time of pandemic. Just talk to Jesus in your own ways, on your thoughts, your mind. So book a date. Our Founders Day is on the 15th of September, which is Our Lady of Sorrows. So more information lined up for you in our preparation for our Founders Day Mass as well. So we also, the Catholic 200 SG, so our CSC ministry will lead the daily rosary on Zoom in October, except on Tuesday. So log in for more information during the month of October, the month of the rosary. And a couple of things you can look up for, the CSC website, daily hour of the hour with Jesus and Mary. So join the rosary and the meditation and CSC channel over the talks as well. So, and lastly, before we go, we thank you once again for each of us who are present during this evening to have a friendship with Jesus in prayer. And we thank you for your support, the mission, and ask of you to bless us through your donations, whatever big or small will do. Perhaps before we end tonight also, we find a blessing. So Father John, kindly give us your final blessing. So as we end tonight, the Lord will grant us a quiet night and a peaceful end, a good night's sleep. Thank you.
Thank you, Father Andrew. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace.
Thank you, Father John.
Thank you, Father Andrew.
Okay, we end with the night, our final song.
Let's thank the Lord in this song.